Data and Society's weekly gathering where we come and invite interesting speakers to tell us about interesting things happening out in the world. I'm very excited to have Ifeoma here with us. She's been around, but this is a great opportunity to have her talking to us about her work. As is ritual at Data and Society, what we're going to do is go around the room so that Ifeoma has a sense of who else is here, what people work on, that gives her a sense of who she's targeting in the audience. This is a way to say your name, your institutional affiliation, and maybe like a small, tiny bit about something you do. So my name is Dana Boyd. I'm the founder of Data and Society and a principal researcher at Microsoft Research. And my work these days is mostly thinking about questions of inequity.
Thank you very much, Dana. And with that, I want to say thank you all for coming. I also want to briefly give a special thanks to Dana, to Eshta, and to Seth, who all made my being here possible today. And I'll be talking with you today about genetic coercion. It's a socio-legal concept that I'm still developing and for which I would, you know, appreciate and love your intellectual pushback. So in thinking about genetic technology, we have to think about what it means to have it and what that implies in terms of social attitudes and also legal implications, right? Chromosomes were first discovered in the late 1800s, and by the early 1900s, inherited disease had been linked to chromosomes. After Watson and Crick, and let's not forget Rosalind Franklin, discovered the molecular structure of DNA in 1953, this bolstered the already present social belief that the workings of the human body could be summed up through genetic information. And this spurred the development of genetic tests. I argued that genetic testing as a technology, as it becomes more accessible, there's an attendant genetic coercion prodding American citizens to relinquish their genetic data in the name of the social good. So what do I mean when I say genetic coercion? Well, I define it as the overwhelming economic, social, and moral compulsion to scrutinize and police the genome that an individual experiences. And to be sure, we have to really break that apart. What do I mean by economic compulsion? Well, this derives from the lack of universal healthcare, which renders life that is infirm or frail financially difficult to sustain. And the social compulsion that stems from the reification of genetic data as the key to social life, such that non-conforming genes must be exposed. In the DNA Mystique, the authors illustrate the high social value now accorded to DNA. And I quote, "As the science of genetics has moved from the laboratory to mass culture, from professional journals to the television screen, the gene has been transformed. Instead of a piece of hereditary information, it has become the key to human relationships and the basis of family cohesion. Instead of a string of purines and pyrimidines, it has become the essence of identity and the source of social difference. Instead of an important molecule, it has become the secular equivalent of the human soul." So what does this mean in the context of genetic coercion? Well, if the DNA is a secular equivalent of the human soul, then the moral compulsion stems from the idea of genetic hygiene for the betterment of society. It is a moral duty of the individual to scrub from her germline deleterious genetic mutations that would be passed down to future generations. This idea is not a new one. In fact, it is directly linked to America's eugenic past. So, the sentence, "three generations of imbeciles are enough," is a well-known one in American law. And it is found in the Supreme Court opinion written for the 1927 case of Buck v. Bell. This case effectively legitimized the eugenics movement in the United States. In it, the Supreme Court ruled that it was lawful to forcefully sterilize on a massive scale persons deemed socially inadequate to bear children. Unfit persons included the poor, the illiterate, the blind, deaf, deformed, diseased, orphans, ne'er-do-wells, homeless, tramps, paupers, as well as criminals and the mentally insane. Following with this idea is the rise of genetic explanations for social behavior. So that case was a 1927 case. However, Troy Duster, in his book, Backdoor to Eugenics, has actually found that there have been subsequent waves of a rise in explanations of genetic explanations for what had previously been considered social behavior dependent on the environment or other factors. So, for example, he found evidence that between 1976 and 1982, there was a 231% increase in articles asserting a genetic basis for crime, mental illness, intelligence, and alcoholism. He also found that from 1983 to 1988, there were articles asserting a genetic explanation for crime and also unemployment. In fact, as you see on the screen, Richard Henstein, a Harvard psychologist who later went on to write the infamous bell curve with Charles Murray, proffered that there could be a genetic explanation for unemployment, not just merely social factors. So, where does the roots of genetic coercion come from? So, today, genetic coercion does not speak in the thunderous language of eugenics, shouting about criminal nature or racial inferiority. Rather, it gently whispers the rhetoric of personal knowledge and agency, right? We are told that genetic testing affords knowledge and also the power to act. Yet we should ask, to whom does this power truly fall? In the history of sexuality, Michel Foucault notes, biopower is governmental power over other bodies. It is an explosion of numerous and diverse technologies for achieving the subjugation of bodies and the control of population. Therefore, biopower, when applied to the phenomenon of genetic testing, speaks to the government's interest in fostering the health of its population, and also in regulating new life, particularly when such life might be deemed burdensome to the state. Thus, we must remember that while genetic testing is most frequently framed in positive terms as life-promoting, it is also life-limiting because it seeks to promote only certain kinds of life, life that is deemed healthy and useful to society. Genetic testing most frequently is the enlistment of the individual citizen as an agent of the state in policing her own bios. So what do I mean by that? Well, for one, genetic testing is presented to African Americans as a way to discover your roots, so genealogical testing. It is also presented to Jewish Americans as a way to discover if you carry the BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutated genes for breast cancer, because this would give you greater agency to make choices that might affect your future risk of the disease. And as we saw in the case of Angelina Jolie Pitt, such testing does prompt life-changing actions, such as surgery to remove the ovaries or the breasts. So, what is the promise of genetic testing, however, when it comes to future generations? And I want to quickly show this video. So essentially, you see that genetic testing and the attendant relinquishment of genetic data is presented as something you do for the greater good, right? To perfect the next generation. It's still you, just a better you. So with that, let's think about all the ways that our genetic data leaves us, right? What are the genetic data streams? So you have genetic data leaving us for genealogical purposes, like I'd mentioned, like for example, African Americans seeking what are called roots search. We also have genetic testing for health predictive reasons. So 23andMe has its health predictive kits where it can tell you your probability of risk for certain diseases such as Alzheimer's, for example. You also have genetic testing for reproductive purposes where people engage in genetic testing prior to getting pregnant. And then you have prenatal genetic testing where, for example, women of advanced maternal age, by which they mean anyone over 35, are experience social pressure and also pressure from their doctors to engage in genetic testing to detect chromosomal abnormalities for their children. We also have newborn genetic testing, which is mandated by the state. So in all 50 states and the District of Columbia, the law says that once a child is born, that child must be subject to genetic testing to detect both hereditary and congenital defects, which, yes, this is useful because, for example, there's PKU, which is a condition that can kill a child shortly after birth, if not immediately detected, and which is very correctable. And such testing does enable for that to be corrected. But you still have to ask. Basically, the newborn is forced to relinquish his or her genetic data at birth without really their consent. Their parents make that consent for them. And the newest stream of genetic data is now actually workplace wellness programs. So what are these? Workplace wellness programs are programs in the workplace really for the primary goal of reducing healthcare costs of the employer and also boosting productivity by creating a healthier, fit work body. But the problem is that workplace wellness programs, because they have been pitched as essentially promoting the health of employees, they enjoy great support by the government, such that the government allows certain exceptions to laws that exist. So for example, a new law that came out through the EEOC is that workplace wellness programs may collect genetic information via family medical history from employees without violating the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act. Mm-hmm. So workplace wellness is now another way for your genetic data to get out. And then finally, we have to situate genetic coercion within the mythology of big data. And what do I mean by that? Well, as Dana Boyd and Kate Crawford have observed, there is a mythology attached to big data. And that mythology is, and I quote, "the widespread belief that large data sets offer a higher form of intelligence and knowledge that can generate insights that were previously impossible and are imbued with the aura of truth, objectivity, and accuracy." Well, genetic coercion is similarly situated within that sort of mythology. The mythology of genetic coercion is thus, that genetic data, especially large-scale genetic databases, have the ability to pinpoint certain risk of disease. They provide the agency to act to prevent such disease, and it can be used to create accurate, personalized treatment for disease, and it should also be entrusted with the authority to dictate the modification of the genome for future generations. And as we have seen, actually, in the cases of both the UK and China, this second part has already been acted upon. As you may all know, the UK recently passed a law allowing for three-parent children. And it was with the goal of essentially eradicating diseases from the germline. And China has recently conducted experiments using CRISPR, which is a gene editing tool in which they basically went in and modified the germline of an embryo. And perhaps I should explain what I mean by a germline. What I mean by a germline modification essentially is when a modification is made within a gene such that that modification will be passed on to any subsequent offspring and not just present in the specific individual that had the gene modified. So with all these ways that our genetic information leaves us, all these streams of genetic data, we should ask, is my genetic data secure? Well, the alarmist answer would be a resounding no. But the more accurate answer is probably, I don't know, right? And ignorance is not bliss, right? So as you see here, these are the reported data breaches for health and medical care data for 2012, 2013, and 2014. However, what you see here, what is actually known. So there's actually more data breaches than are actually reported. So that should give you pause because you might think, I haven't heard anything, my data is all good. Maybe, maybe not. And as I say, ignorance is not bliss. And we should also be wary of particularly the large-scale collection of genetic data from newborns, because there are no hard and fast rules as to what happens to that actual genetic matter. And it's just a speck of blood that's usually taken, but anybody with genetic knowledge knows that speck of blood is a lot. It contains a lot of information. And there's no hard and fast rules as to what happens to that speck of blood. There's no hard and fast rules to ensure that it's destroyed after genetic testing, or that it is accurately or securely secured from data breaches. So we should be concerned. I'm sorry. I also did want to mention about gene theft and genetic identity theft. So gene theft is actually not against the law. What does that mean? It means if I drink from this bottle and I leave it here and I exit, you are perfectly within the federal law. Some states do now have laws to take this bottle, send it to a genetic testing company and discover my full genome. So gene testing is actually not a federal crime in the US. It is in the UK, but in many jurisdictions all over the world and including the US, it is not. Genetic identity thefts is also something that's on the rise. And this might sound futuristic to you, but it's actually a fact. Researchers in Israel have discovered that it is possible to, just by knowing the code, not having any genetic material from a person, but just knowing their genomic code, to create material that mimics that person's genetic material, such that that material can be left at a crime scene, for example, leading investigators to believe that a different person committed the crime that actually did. So this is reality. And then of course, there's the data breaches that happens frequently. Anthem is a healthcare insurer that just announced a major data breach. And it is worth noting actually that electronic health records are actually the most lucrative data for data thieves. It's actually more lucrative than credit card data. Okay, so why should we care about genetic data security? Well, genetic data security does have implications for both privacy and discrimination. From the privacy aspect, we have to recognize that there still is social stigma towards disease, particularly cognitive diseases. Much research has been done to show that there is especially a stigma attached to Alzheimer's, such that people who have been diagnosed, which is probably not the accurate word, but have been discovered to have a propensity for Alzheimer's. Note, they're not suffering from Alzheimer's, they just have the propensity for future disease. Those people actually experience stigma even before displaying signs of the disease. So that is one of the ways we should, that is one of the reasons why we should care about privacy. We should also care about privacy in the context of discrimination. In one of my law review articles, I talk about healthism in the United States. And that is basically the fact that the employer is a major health insurer for most Americans, means that the employer has a vested interest in excluding for consideration for employment those individuals whom the employer deems as costly for its healthcare costs. So that this can open up individuals to employment discrimination when they're found to have genetic disease. Also, you might be thinking, don't they have laws for this? This is America. We have so many laws, we must be protected. Well, they have laws, but the laws are not as protective as you might think. So I'll start with the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, HIPAA. So the common social perception is that HIPAA protects your medical information, right? The common perception is that if you go to your doctor and you tell them anything about your health, or they do tests on you, that information is ironclad protected. Not so fast. So HIPAA is actually not a privacy protection law, right? The main objective of HIPAA was to allow you to take your information from one doctor to the next, from one insurer to the next. That's really the main objective of HIPAA. Such, it doesn't really protect your privacy in the way that you might imagine, right? For one, only there is a very limited circle of covered entities. So really only medical care providers are protected. What does this mean? Genetic testing companies are not covered by HIPAA. They're not medical providers. Also, you have to actually ask what the provisions of HIPAA are. And the provisions of HIPAA are thus: your medical information can be released for the purposes of both treatment and payment. So as you see, your medical information can and will leave your doctor's office primarily to go to health insurers. So the Anthem breach that just occurred, I guarantee you there was also genetic information that was derived from that by the data breach. So we have to keep that in mind, that while there are laws, they may not be as protective as we might think. Also, you might say, well, there's the Americans with Disabilities Act, right? As Americans, unlike some other countries, we care about disabled people. We care about protecting their right to work, to socialize. Well, we do. But the problem is genetic disease, which is not manifested, is not considered a disability. So for the American with Disabilities Act to actually apply, you have to have a manifest physical disease that is disabling. So for example, if you have the sickle cell trait, but you don't have the crisis that a sickle cell, that somebody suffering from full-blown sickle cell disease has, you're not covered by the ADA, albeit that you may experience the same stigma and discrimination. And finally, we come to the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act. GINA to the rescue. Now, what does GINA do? So GINA is the newest among all these laws. And GINA was an attempt by the federal government to protect our genetic information. So GINA is explicitly both an anti-discrimination law and a privacy law. So Title II of GINA says that your employer cannot use your genetic information to discriminate against you for employment, hiring, or promotion purposes. However, GINA has many, many loopholes. For one, you actually have to prove that your employer has discriminated against you. GINA does not allow a disparate impact provision. Okay. GINA also protects you against having your insurance denied, your health insurance denied, on the basis of the fact that you have a genetic propensity for disease. However, there's also a loophole there. GINA only applies to health insurance. It does not apply to long-term care insurance, disability insurance, or life insurance. So if you take a genetic test and you find out you have Alzheimer's, and somehow this information gets out to insurers, you might find yourself unable to procure life insurance. And this would be perfectly lawful. Okay. So finally, how do we go about protecting a genetic data, right? This is a hard question, right? It might not be for you computer scientists, it might not be MP hard, but I'll call it, you know, quantified self hard. It is a difficult question. Because while technology might seem like the obvious approach, data breaches are so ubiquitous that we really have to think about really how we go about securing data such that we don't lose the accessibility, because genetic data is useful and some people might want to share their genetic data, right? For either for research purposes, for creativity purposes, but they might not want it to be used against them when they're trying to apply for a job or get insurance. So how do we protect our genetic data while also maintaining accessibility for all the useful things it can do? Well, some of the solutions that have come out is a system of locks and keys, right? Wherein genetic information may be stored in a database. And in that database, people can have access and varying levels of access based on a system of locks and keys. So for example, your genetic data can be in a database, and then you can allow access for, say, a research, a research university to study a particular allele of your genome for, cure Parkinson's. But that university wouldn't have access to your entire genome. They would just have access to that allele and perhaps the way information from you in terms of your, like things like your daily life, like the way you exercise, your eating habits, et cetera. So that's one option in terms of giving limited and particular and specific access. But it still entails having your genetic data in a database, and there's still issues there. So I can't claim to have a solution to this, and I would love if some of you do, right? I don't necessarily advocate for more laws, right? Because as we have seen, we do have laws. The problem is that there are so many loopholes within the laws that we already have. What I do advocate is perhaps strengthening some of the laws that we do already have, in particular GINA, right? If we can strengthen GINA with a disparate impact provision clause, I think this will help in terms of the issues of employment discrimination that can arise from data breaches, genetic data breaches. I also think education is key, right? Educating both the general public and the government about what genetic information really is, right? Its utility, but also its limitations, right? Recognizing that it's not really the panacea that it is presented as, perhaps by companies seeking to make a profit from it. And finally, I want us to think about what are the seeds for future research, right? I particularly am interested in learning about American beliefs and attitudes regarding genetic data. How has this changed over the years, and what accounts for these changes? For example, what is the extent of scientific knowledge that your average American holds regarding genetic data? And how does this influence consumer behavior? What are issues regarding the use of genetic data in personalized medicine, both ethical and legal? What are ethical issues regarding the sale of genetic data, especially considering that your genetic data is not just you, it's also all your future generations? Do you really have the authority to make the sale or to even publicize your genetic data in this way. So with that, I want to thank you all for coming, and I look forward to your questions and comments. Thank you very much.
Questions? Hi, thanks, Ifeoma. That was super interesting.
Thank you.
So I have a question for you about kind of the intersection of genetic data and like behavioral control.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been noticing like in the news lately several cases in which DNA is used, not really like because we're interested per se in the genetic information that it contains, but DNA testing gets used to identify somebody who's accused of some sort of wrongdoing. So I just saw like last week there was a case in which like a waiter in Syracuse, New York spit in a drink and the police like tested his DNA. I mean, it's like, it's maybe overblown, mm-hmm, but the police like tested his DNA and charged him with disorderly conduct based on a match between like the spit and him. And then mm-hmm. there's a case I think pending in the Ninth Circuit where these employees were like leaving piles of feces around. You know,
the devious defecator.
The devious defecator
case. It has become
yeah.
as known as the devious defecator case.
Yeah, which I think is brought under, I think this, so the employees, I guess the employees weren't the devious defecators,
yeah.
but I'm pretty sure, you know more about this than I do, but I'm pretty sure they're suing under GINA, saying.
Yeah, they did sue under GINA.
Yeah. Tell us more about the case.
Yeah, so it's a really funny case. So I think they were working in some sort of like warehouse,
yeah.
And somebody was leaving piles of feces around the warehouse. And the employers decided that the best way to discover who was doing this, you know, was to test their employees. But they didn't test all the employees, which also is an interesting part of the case. They decided that it must be a group of people and only tested those people. They essentially forced them to give up their genetic data. It turns out it wasn't actually them. But that didn't matter because those people being singled out to be tested, actually that exposed them to ridicule by their coworkers. And it, you know, it became a hostile work environment for them, essentially. But they brought suit on the GINA, which technically isn't what GINA was really anticipating, I would think. But it worked because that was a clear case of an employer requesting genetic data from an employee in terms of like, if you don't give us your genetic data, you will be fired.
Yeah.
So, in going back to your question, yes, there has been a significant rise in genetic data being used for crime solving, essentially, purposes, right? So a colleague of mine at my law school actually has written an article called Predictive Policing. And it's basically the idea that policing now it's more about prediction than actual entrapment or actually catching the person red-handed. It's more like predicting who did it. Because what we still need to understand is that DNA is still a prediction. It's just saying, I predict to this, you know, level of probability that this is a person that did it, right? So there is a rise in that. And in fact, an interesting part of that rise is the use of DNA for phenotyping. So there was a case where genetic data was left at a rape crime scene, and the data was used basically to decide what the rapist might look like in terms of skin color, height, and that led to sort of like narrow the field of who the suspect could be. So there's a rise in that, but there's also obviously a rise in scientists calling foul because genetic data, particularly for phenotyping, is highly fraught. Because in terms of, for example, skin tone, there's actually hundreds of genes that actually affect skin tone. And that interacts also with environment and diet, et cetera, et cetera. So you can't really be quite accurate with that. Hopefully that answers your question. Yeah.
This is quite fascinating. Are there any legislatures, either at a state or in the U.S. or outside of the world, that kind of have taken on these issues to be the example that U.S. should be looking at?
Well, I think the U.S. should definitely look at the U.K. in terms of genetic, what is called gene theft. So currently the U.S. has, and I'm talking federally, because California, for example, does have laws against gene theft. But currently, federally, the U.S. has a position it takes of abandoned DNA. So if you spit out your gum in public, or you leave a cup that you drank from at a restaurant, that is considered abandoned DNA, such that for anyone to take that genetic material, it is not gene theft. The UK actually has a blanket ban against gene theft. And can I tell you why they do so? I'll tell you why. In the early 2000s, a journalist came out with the story that Prince Henry, Harry, as he's called, is not the son of Prince Charles. And there was a theory that he was actually the son of a butler who had worked there and with whom Princess Diana had had an affair. And there was concocted a plan to steal some of Prince Harry's DNA in order to test it against the butler who was cooperating to determine if he was indeed the butler's son. So that is actually why the UK has a blanket ban against gene theft. Yes.
Abandoned DNA?
Oh, I love that question. I love that question. So I'll give you several cases. I love that question. So the first one, I'm just, because there's so many cases, you know, so many stories, I'm just trying to see which one I should pick from. But the first one I'll start with is this. So there was a case in which a man received oral pleasure from a woman, and the woman collected the sperm and subsequently used that to inseminate herself. And the woman then later sued him for what? Child support. And the man filed a countersuit for fraud and theft, right? Saying that she stole his sperm. Well, that case was adjudicated as not theft. He was deemed to have made a gift of the sperm. So there's that. So that's the story now.
But would that apply in a UK scenario?
Mm-hmm. So in the UK scenario, that perhaps would have been deemed gene theft, right? Because you could say he wasn't giving it to her for the purposes of, you know, later inseminating herself. But in the American scenario, it was abandoned DNA for her to do as she pleases. Or more importantly, actually, this case, Rudy, was a gift for which you could, you know, as it is a gift, you can do with it whatever you want, right? So, yeah.
Hi. I wanted to ask about what you thought about just desperate there's privacy by design. Anne Kavakian, she advocates, okay, organizations can collect as much data as they want as long as privacy is set as a default setting. Mm-hmm. Then there are tech companies that mm-hmm. are making sure that organizations have a least privileged model. So you have like different organizations or just people doing different things. How do we, I kind of feel like they need to talk to each other more, and just there are bits and pieces of like app developers who are really interested in just the technology, and kind of just it's not that they don't care about privacy, that's not something that they're just thinking about. How do we just address, I don't want to sound so gloom and doom, because there's so many things to be worried about, but there are people and organizations that are working on that. I wanted to hear your thoughts.
I think that's a really interesting question, because, you know, there's the idea of that, you know, we should all become Facebook with our genetic data, right? And some people have actually put this in practice. There is a man who has a Facebook for genetic data. So you can join with your genetic data, and it's open to everyone in the network, and it's for artistic, creative expression. But this idea of, I guess it's called privileging.
Privacy by design.
Privacy by design, I don't buy it. Just because there's just too many instances of data breaches. And even if it's not from without, it can come from within. Sure.
But there are organizations, or I work at a data security company, mm-hmm. and they are trying to sell that the least privileged model and auditing everybody's data access, and that, you know, you shouldn't get access to stuff that you don't need. And there are companies that do that, and that there are people working on it. I just kind of feel like who should be the data owner too when to our own personal data?
I think that last question is still really the most pressing one. Who should own your data, right? So 23andMe recently brokered a deal where all the genetic data it had collected from its clients who had checked the box for research, it was able to sell for like $60 million. And the question is, should then the clients get some of that money back, right? Because did they really, when they clicked the box for research, were they giving it up altruistically, like for public research, or were they really giving it up for private research of the kind that 23andMe is basically selling it for? So those are unanswered questions that remain, and I can't claim to have the answers. And I think it's definitely things that we should continue to think about as we, you know, engage in genetic testing, for sure.
I'm going to take moderator's privilege for a moment. One of the things I struggle with whenever we talk about the privacy by design issue or about these questions of individual control is genetic material is one of the most beautiful examples of material for which it's not clear who the owner is because it's network data.
Mm-hmm.
The information that is your genetic material to theoretically give out or to have exposed in different ways fundamentally affects your children and your not yet living grandchildren.
Exactly.
And so, not to mention all
and
of
your living
families.
And your living relatives.
And people you don't know. So one of the things that's been happening in the LAPD is that they've collected a massive database of genetic material and they're going and looking for suspects relatives.
Familial matches.
Right. Yeah. But the thing is, they keep showing up at the doorsteps of people that don't know they have half siblings.
Exactly, exactly.
And so one of the things that I think is another ethical consideration for all of this, and a technical, a legal, a social, is how do we account for the people who effectively have no choice because they're related to the people who theoretically have choice?
Yeah.
And how do we reframe or think about those networks of responsibility with regard to the privacy, ownership, responsibility elements?
It's something I've given a lot of thought for, particularly in the context of the 23andMe, you know, this wholesale, you know, basically transfer of genetic information to a corporate entity. I feel fairly certain that many of the people who check that box, they didn't do so knowingly. They might have done so voluntarily, but in contract language, you actually have to do something both knowingly and voluntarily. And knowingly means you understand the full repercussions of when you sign that contract. And for the 23andMe case, I suspect that several of the people who signed that, they didn't understand that this means your genetic information, your children's genetic information, your grandchildren's genetic information, your mother's genetic information can end up within a corporate entity or several corporate entities for whatever purpose, right? Because that's the thing, they don't even have a say in the purpose of that genetic information and how it's used. So I think it's a really weighty question because it is a network issue. It's not really so much an individual privacy, personal agency issue the way it's presented, right, by the genetic testing companies. And I mean, some of the ways I've thought about it is what I mentioned earlier about the allowing access to genetic data, but for limited portions or for limited uses, right? So you could, for example, be allowed to sell your genetic data to a corporate company, but only for your lifetime, for example, such that after your lifetime, they would have to destroy both the matter that they have and the information that they have, and then they would have to ask for permission again from your descendants if they wanted to continue using that data. So that's one way, but it's a very weighty issue and one that needs serious thought.
Fantastic talk.
Thank you very much.
Just with your sort of seeds for future research, I wanted to, maybe you can speculate a little bit, and you mentioned that you want to start looking at the sort of trends of American attitudes towards genetic testing. What do you think you're going to find? And does anything sort of scare you, particularly, you know, because you know so much about the history of eugenics and such. Do you see a sort of resurgence of that? And then maybe just a second one is there any, you talked a little bit about comparative attitudes, you know, UK versus UK. Is there any country do you think that is doing it really well or really far behind? Sort of also what you're saying.
So I smile when you say speculate because, you know, as a social scientist, I'm not allowed to speculate. But as a science fiction aficionado, I will speculate. I suspect, right, that most Americans have a very low scientific knowledge of genetic data and what it really means and what it is to begin with. And what it can do and what it cannot do, right? I suspect that most Americans, if they have any knowledge of genetic data, it's not from schooling, it's from advertisements, right? It's from the things that the corporate companies are telling them genetic data can do, a lot of which are hyperbole. You can have hyperbole in advertising. But, you know, a lot of Americans don't necessarily have the scientific tools to be able to separate the hyperbole from the science fact. So I suspect that as a result of this, there will be more and more genetic testing. More people are going to say, sign me up. I want to know my exact risk of Alzheimer's, which, frankly, isn't really what you're getting. You're getting whether you have the gene that could cause Alzheimer's, but you're not really going to get your exact risk because that depends on so many other things, your environment, the kind of job that you do, your social life, your diet, if you do brain exercises like luminosity. I mean, it's like, there's depending on so many different factors, but I suspect that the average American is seduced by the promise of genetic testing. And as a result, there will be more and more. And also, there will be more and more of a eugenics bent to it. So right now, it's presented mostly for, you know, finding disease and preventing disease. So that's the language now. But I believe that later on, the language is going to go more to what you see in Gattaca, which is creating the perfect baby, creating your ideal baby, right? Creating the baby that reflects the best of you. You know, so I think that's the wave of the future.
Hi, my question actually sort of ties into what you said before. And I was wondering, how do you see ensuring or answering the question, who has the responsibility to ensure that there's informed consent on parts of whomever is opening their genetic data? Because, for instance, a case we had in the Netherlands, where I'm originally from, is that we tried to establish a thing which was called the open patient dossier, where everything would be digitized. So if you were to have a heart attack in one city and the doctor didn't have your prior medical records, it could get them really easily. And now there was a lot of pushback on this, specifically for the examples that you mentioned. Data breaches, it's too easy, it wasn't secure, et cetera, et cetera. So one of the things that was extremely effective in the campaign against this dossier is saying that, well, we're going to make the GPs partially responsible for anything that goes wrong. And if they haven't informed their patients well enough, that is partially on them, which led most GPs to actively discourage their patients from signing on.
I can imagine.
If they make a mistake that we can't control, not only are you in a unpleasant spot, but so are we. So I was kind of wondering, how do you see that debate taking place here, and who should have that sort of responsibility to ensure that there is real informed consent? Because as you just said, you can't expect people to know not even just the genetics of this, but the intersection with all the different things here, it's impossible.
That's a really great question, because the funny thing, there was a survey done in 2011, and it found that actually 85% of doctors had never heard of Gina. So if that's who you're relying on to, you know, tell you about genetic data protections, you're going to be at a loss. So I frankly don't think the burden should be on the doctors. I think the burden is on the government, because the government is having these laws, like the newborn testing law, that's requiring, coercing people to relinquish their genetic data. And as such, the government then has a burden to protect that data and also to educate people about how they can go about protecting your data even beyond that. So I think the government has a duty to educate all healthcare workers, not just doctors, nurses, everyone, about genetic data and also the protections of the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act and its limitations, right? Because one thing that happens is that Americans think, oh, there's a law on that, I'm protected. And that's not entirely the case. So it's also about educating about, here's your rights under the law, but also here are the limitations of the law, just so you can give informed consent. Now, some of the people who signed up for 23andMe, maybe they had vaguely heard of Gina, right? And maybe they knew it prevented your employer from getting your genetic information. But did they know, for example, that if by signing off for 23andMe and discovering that they have Alzheimer's, they now may no longer be able to buy life insurance? Did they know that? And if they knew that, might that have changed the decision, right? So that's what I talk about, knowing consent. They voluntarily gave consent, but was it really knowing?
Thanks a lot for this discussion. This is really interesting.
Thank you.
I had a specific question. You'd mentioned that stolen genetic data is worth more than credit card data.
Mm-hmm.
Could you talk a little bit about the market for stolen genetic data?
So usually the stolen genetic data is not the most targeted. They're targeting medical records, and which will contain some genetic data. So it's actually medical records in general that are the most lucrative, as opposed to like data, as opposed to credit card, et cetera. And the reason why is this. People basically use it to impersonate you and use your health insurance. So for example, getting access to your medical record, a person can sign up to have surgery that's like $300,000 surgery, for example. Whereas with your credit card, they might be able to get $2,000 before you cancel it or something like that. Yes.
Very interesting talk.
Thank you.
At the beginning, you mentioned, you sort of mentioned universal health insurance and sort of notions of participation. So my question is obviously, you know, if the LAPD is collecting caches of data, or the FBI is collecting caches of data from in the course of their police work, then the DNA databases they have reflect the police practices they engage in, which many of us might agree are discriminatory. If there were a different kind of level of participation in the giving up genetic information, would that change the way you think about the problems surrounding genetic privacy and genetic, like how would that change the kind of talk you might give about this?
Okay, so I guess to understand your question, you're saying if the genetic databases were voluntary, right? and maybe open?
Maybe like, I mean, this might raise a whole bunch of other problematic, you know, issues. Mm-hmm. But imagine a world where, you know, everybody had to have their DNA on file, right? Everyone.
Uh-huh.
So,
uh-huh.
So
uh-huh.
You know,
I do imagine you could, such a world.
Right. I see. Right. Exactly. So they do this, and some populations have, you know, done this for research.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
So, I guess does that change? Like, how does it? What are the issues? How does that resolve some of these issues or not resolve them, or and it maybe mm-hmm. maybe it raises new questions that we might worry about.
I don't necessarily think it resolves these issues. I think it makes it easier actually to it would make it easier to discriminate, right? If everybody has a genetic data on file, you now no longer have to ask them family medical history. You just go look up and say, oh, I would hire that person, but I see they have this slightly elevated Alzheimer's risk, so no. So in a way, it actually would open up a larger can of worms. Like for me, I'm not so much concentrating on the, criminal enforcement aspect as I am on the employment and social aspects, where I feel that large-scale genetic collection could actually lead to what you see in Gattaca, because that is what is Gattaca, right? Everybody has their genetic information on file. And with that, certain people are classified as valid, and then the others are classified as invalid, depending on the number of genetic mutations they have. So the more genetic mutations you have, the less likely you are to ascend the social ladder, essentially. So you're relegated to certain jobs, right? So I don't necessarily think it'll solve the problem. I actually think it might exacerbate it.
Well, fantastic. I know we're out of time, but I want to say thank you so much for invigorating talks. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming.